salvation is all about. Let's break it on down this morning. Let's get on over there. This is going to be fun and scary. Verse 1, chapter 1. The revelation, the apocalypse of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy. Hey, I'm going to be blessed this morning. Doesn't matter what your response is. I'm going to be blessed. I'm reading the words of this prophecy. And blessed are those who hear it. Are you going to be blessed? Well, now you don't know. You didn't finish reading. Blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it. Because the time is near. In three verses, the power of this book is undeniable. It's inspired men to write such songs as the Hallelujah Chorus. And I have a dream that one day as a congregation, Matt Sullivan's going to lead us in that one. But it's also given birth to many isolated sectarian religious movements, largely misfocused on passages that talk about the thousand-year reign of Christ, the millennium. And so you have premillennialists who believe Jesus comes, and then there's a thousand-year reign. And then there are postmillennialists who say there's a thousand-year reign, and then Christ comes. Basically, the book of Revelation is an amillennialist book. It's a misunderstanding of what the scriptures teach. And yet, men like Charles Russell of Jehovah's Witnesses have categorized certain verses like the 144,000 that are saved. And you go, what if I'm 144,001? Am I out? Well, in his interpretation, you would be. But even here is a very simple misunderstanding. The numbers in the book of Revelation are very consistent, and they hold a purposeful meaning. 144 is simply 12. Times 12. I think the PSU students would give me an amen on that. And 1,000 is 10 times 10 times 10. Of course, we need the Reed College kids to give us an amen on that one. And then if you put that all together, 144,000 is 12 times 12 times 10 times 10 times 10. The number 12, the number 10 are perfect numbers. And so 12, 12, 10, 10, 10. Those are the perfect in Christ, those are the saved, but we're not limited to 144. You know that of a recent tragedy of the Branch Davidians in Waco, Texas. Likewise, drew falsely off passages. David Koresh, and the name Koresh in Hebrew is Cyrus. Their fundamental belief was not the plan of God through the ages was Jesus, but the plan of God was Koresh. And of course, he leads them into the fires of oblivion. Many see this as an explanation of the European Union or the war in Iraq. And yet the words of the scripture are clear and it's spoken over and over again. The time is near. This is a letter like all the other letters. It's written by an apostle to the people of that day. Yes, the application is primarily to the churches of that hour. And yet, as we find right here, it's addressed to the seven churches of Asia. Verse 4. And you say, but aren't there more than seven churches in Asia? And of course, Asia is not what we think of Asia. Asia in the Bible was the province of Asia in the western part of Turkey. And we remember from Acts chapter 19, all those that have already gone through first principles know this, that Paul started to work in Ephesus, and in 2 years' time, from that campus ministry, in the lecture hall of Tyrannus, the word of God spread throughout all the province of Asia, and that's when these churches were started. And yet we know biblically that the province of Asia included the church in Colossae, as well as Hierapolis. So there were more than seven churches, but why seven? Well, once more, the number has significance. The number seven is also a perfect number, and so the teaching of Christ was very simply this. Yes, it's to the seven churches of Asia, but the number seven is not only perfect, but complete. And so what he's saying is, this applies to all the churches. And so this scripture, yes, is primarily addressed to the churches of that hour, but as we believe with all scripture, it is to be applied in a timeless way to all generations. Are you with me here, church? Yes. These are events that the church then would be able to say, these events soon took place. The writing of this letter, some say it's in the mid-70s AD, some say mid-80s. I believe that it's about the mid-90s. Shocking is that there's a lot of controversy over who wrote it. I just looked down at verse 4 and it says John, so I believe John. Now some people, and people get sucked into false doctrine pretty easily, they say, well, this isn't John the Apostle. And they go to a very obscure verse, but I'm sure you know it. In Revelation 21, I believe, verse 14, where the writer talks about heaven, and in heaven the names of the 12 apostles are going to be inscribed. And some of these expert theologians have said, well, if this were John the Apostle, he would have said, well, the 12 apostles, the 11 other apostles, and then my name would be inscribed. Let me tell you something. If you're a humble dog like John was, you say, hey, the 12 apostles get their name up there. That is the most ridiculous exegesis I've ever heard in my life. This is John the Apostle, who's on the island of Patmos. You say, where is that? It's the middle of the Aegean Sea, halfway between Greece and halfway between Turkey in our modern day maps. And he's there, the Bible says, because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. Let's continue reading in verse 4. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father. To him be glory and power forever and ever. The church said, look, he's coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be, the church said. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. Yes, God Almighty reigns. You know, it's interesting. The phrase, who is, and who was, and who is to come, and in these short five verses, it's mentioned twice, must have great significance, and you're correct. Actually, back in the day, back in the first century, there was a very popular saying that said, Zeus was, Zeus is, and Zeus shall be. Well, Jesus didn't like that. He says, I want you to know what the truth is. Life is not all about Zeus. It's about Jesus, who is, who was, and who is to come. The sad thing, that had to be written not for the world, but for the Christians who wanted to assimilate into society. But what is the theme of the book of Revelation? It's real simple. It's real simple. It's the title of our lesson today. Faithful to the end. Faithful to the end. Now, we're only going to be able to get to the first chapter and the first two churches of the seven churches today. But the message, I think, will be clear. We find in Revelations 1:5 that it says that this revelation is from Jesus, who is the faithful witness. Now, here's something really cool, guys. The word witness in Greek is martys, M-A-R-T-Y-S. It's where we get our English word martyr. Pretty awesome, huh? So to be a witness in Greek is to be a martyr. That's what it meant to be a witness. And we're going to find from the scriptures, and we'll overview in just a second, that to be faithful in the eyes of God is to be a faithful witness. Faithful to the end. Look at verse 9. Even as John introduces a letter, he says, I, John, your brother and companion in suffering and kingdom and in patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the Isle of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. He was there because he obeyed the word of God and he preached the word of God. Look at chapter 2, verse 10. Do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. Is that intense? Look at this next one, verse 13, chapter 2. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne. Sound like Portland? Yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. Faithfulness in the book of Revelations is over and over and over again connected to three things. Number one, holding the word of God or obeying it. A faithful proclamation and a faithful proclamation to all nations. Look at chapter 5. Verse 9. And they sang a new song. It's always awesome to sing a new song, isn't it, church? And we know we kid our song leaders a little bit here and there, but I think our song leaders do an awesome job. Amen, church. And they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals because you were slain. And with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on earth. This is not some futuristic vision. This is, he's saying, listen, the disciples, the Christians, are going to reign on earth. Does that fire you on up? That's so cool. But he says, look, the kingdom, what is the kingdom composed of? It's people from every tribe, every language, every people, and every nation. It was a proclamation to the lost world. Amen, church? The same worldview is given in chapter 7, verse 9. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. Of course, colors in the Bible have a great significance in the book of Revelation. White signifies purity. Gold, usually, there are some exceptions, but gold signifies martyrdom. So when you find someone has a gold crown, the crown symbolizes eternal life. But the gold says they got there by martyrdom. Pretty cool, huh? Chapter 12, verse 11. This is how they overcame Satan. They overcame Satan by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. The Bible teaches if you are not a faithfully proclaiming Christian, then you are not faithful to God. But the call of the scripture is be faithful to the end. Now it's interesting. There are two possible ends, death or the second coming. Whichever one comes first, that's the one you're getting off on. And so the end is very important, whichever way it comes. But it's interesting. The Bible is going to break down today God's equal concern for those that are in a bad situation, poverty and persecution, and those that are in a good situation, wealth and prosperity. Because the challenge of faithfulness is equally challenged. Now, that's not how we think. We understand that persecution, name-calling, threats of death and death itself, that could back someone off from being a disciple. Are you with me right here? But many times we don't think that when things are going good, when we have more than enough money and we buy a house and we buy a bigger house and a better car. I'm not saying that these in and of themselves are wrong, but I am saying that very often that becomes the focus of our lives, and then we drift away from God. And the Bible says right here, Didn't make any difference whether it was a good time or a bad time. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. And we contact the blood in the waters of baptism. Amen? By the word of their testimony. How they overcome? They faithfully proclaimed Christ every day. And they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Chapter 14. In verse 6. Then I saw another angel flying in midair, and he had an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who live on earth, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. I mean, you get the sense that God wanted to get the word out to the whole world here? Here's an awesome scripture. This one's incredible. Revelation 14, 15. Then another angel came out of the temple and called in a loud voice to him who was sitting on the cloud, take your sickle and reap, because the time to harvest has come, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. Wow! God wants the earth harvested. He wanted it harvested then, and he wants it harvested now. Are you with me, church? And then in chapter 19, another angel greets John in verse 10. At this I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, don't do it. I'm a fellow servant with you and with your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. It's very clear from the scriptures that to be a true Christian, to be a disciple, to be saved, we must be faithful to the end. We must hold to the word of God. We must continue to testify to Jesus Christ. And we must have a world view that the gospel needs to go to every tribe, every nation, every language. Are you with me here, church? Now, let's dig in to the text. Faithful to the end. Verse 9. Ah, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus was on the Isle of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit. Are you in the Spirit today, church? And I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. It said, write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And among the lampstands was someone like the Son of Man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. His head and his hair were white as wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in the furnace. His voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held the seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp, double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all of its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Right here, in the opening scene of the book of Revelation, we find the Apostle John, an old man who had seen it all, who was now alone on the island of Patmos. And yet he wasn't, because he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And on that day, he heard a voice like a trumpet, a strong voice. And when he turned around to see whose voice it was, he saw Jesus. But he didn't see a little baby in a manger. He didn't see some white, thin, effeminate white guy. He didn't see someone defeated hanging on the cross, still hanging there. Now, when he turned around, he saw the glorified, exalted, reigning Son of God. You know why people don't obey the word of God? It's because they see Jesus as a little baby. They see Jesus as some milk-toast, effeminate white guy. They see him still on the cross. Let me tell you something. You turn around and see this Jesus, you go, What do you need me to do? And the Bible says right here, here's what I want you to do, John. Take out a scroll. I want you to take notes today. And I want you to write to seven churches. And the Bible says, he turned around and saw seven gorgeous, beautiful lampstands. And then he saw someone like the Son of Man. Absolutely a reference to Daniel chapter 7. And perhaps even the fourth man in the fires. That was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Who was the fourth dude? The Son of Man. He was dressed in princely garb, in a robe that reached down to his feet, and with a golden sash, signifying his princely state, but also the martyrdom by which he got it. The Bible says his head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow. White signifies purity. His thinking, his words, his mind was totally pure. That is our Jesus. His eyes were like blazing fire. They could burn through any veneer that a human being puts up. He knows everything. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace. Solid, steady, immovable. And his voice was like the sound of rushing water. In his right hand, he held the seven stars. Say, what are the seven stars? Well, those are the angels of the churches. What's that signifying? Well, you know, the Bible says in Isaiah that one night God got ticked off at this guy called Sennacherib. And he had an army of 185,000 trained fighting men. God sent one ordinary angel to deal with them that night, and 185,000 men died. And right here we see Jesus just in his right hand. Who knows what's in the left? In his right hand, he's got seven of these angels. That's power. And then the Bible says, and out of his mouth came a sharp, double-edged sword. We know from the book of Hebrews, that is the word of God. And Jesus speaks the word of God. Are you with me, church? And his face was like the sun, shining. Have you ever seen the sun just shining so bright? You look at it, you stare, and you only stare at it for so long. And even when you turn away, there's that red dot that stays there. He says, I just couldn't even look at Jesus too long. He was that brilliant. He was that glorious. He said, I can only think of one thing to do. Faint. So he falls down. So what did Jesus do? Kick him? Hey, dude, get back up. Now the Bible says right here, verse 17, then Jesus placed his right hand on me. Signifying, remember what the Bible says? His right hand, he held the seven stars. So he put the seven stars down. So he places them down. And you got to be very careful with beings that destroy 185,000 men in one time. You're very careful with those. You put the seven stars down. And with this same powerful hand, he gently touches John. What an image, amen, church? He said, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead. And behold, I'm alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore what you have seen, what is now and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. See, the book of Revelation is not a difficult book to discern. Jesus is going to lay it out. But we need to understand it was a message for the church of that day. Now, this morning, we'll only be able to read two of the, what I call the mini letters to the churches. There are, of course, seven. We're going to talk today about Ephesus and Smyrna. And what you're going to find is that each one of these letters follows pretty much the same pattern. First of all, Jesus addresses the church because he says, hey, I want you to know what I'm thinking about you in particular. Secondly, he says, I want to give you some encouragement. That's just our Lord, you know it? He says, I want to tell you something good that you're doing. Then gives them the rebuke about that which is taking them away from God. Then he says, hold it. If you listen, if you repent, then here's the promise, because you're going to overcome. See, Jesus believes in us. Let's look at the church in Ephesus. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. It's cool to know that Jesus is walking among the churches, is it not? I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked men, and that you've tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You've persevered and have endured hardships for my name, and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Remember the height from which you've fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, who's that? That's all of us. Okay, check it out right there. Okay. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. He says, listen, it's going to be as awesome as it was right in the beginning in the Garden of Eden, if you guys listen to me. Well, now, what's he say right here? Well, you know, actually, the first three verses I find terribly encouraging. It says, hey, I know your deeds. You know, and Jesus knows what you're all about. He says, yeah, but does he know? Does he know my heart? Well, you know something? Here's what the Bible teaches. Your deeds tell God all about your heart. That's the teaching of God's word. So you're saying good intentions don't count? Precisely. Exactly. Your deeds show God where your heart's at. I know your deeds. Your hard work and your perseverance. Well, that's cranking. Wouldn't you like to have the Lord come up to you? Dude. Or dudette. I just gotta say, you're a hard worker. You persevere. Man, I don't know about you, but thank you, Jesus. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked men, that you've tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You've persevered and endured hardships for my name, have not grown weary. You're still attending church. Isn't it interesting right here that one of the things that he commends them for is that they have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, false apostles. I find this relatively interesting that this is a compliment that Jesus goes out of his way to make to the church at Ephesus. It must be a very significant compliment. For a lot of us, we gloss over it because we don't understand it in our understanding of God's word. See, we think of apostles as being the original 12 and then adding Paul as the one who's abnormally born, and that is true. But biblically, there were more apostles than that. The word apostle just simply means, in the Greek, one who's sent out, or in our modern-day vernacular, a messenger. And so even in the Bible, in Acts 14:14, even Barnabas is called an apostle. And there are others at the end of the book of Romans that are called apostles. Ones who are sent out, messengers. Now, Paul himself deals with some false apostles, which all we're talking about are preachers right here. Some false preachers. Let's go over and look at that passage, because if Ephesus gets commended for this, we'd like to at least get a commendation in the Lord, right? Amen, guys? Let's go over quickly to 2 Corinthians. Look at what Paul writes the church at Corinth. Verse 1. I hope that you'll put up with a little of my foolishness, but you're already doing that. I'm jealous for you with a godly jealousy. I promised you the one husband to Christ so that I might present you as a pure virgin to him. See, Paul was the planter of the church at Corinth. And because he planted the church, he cared for all the disciples in the church. And he gave them, when he first gave them, he gave them the gospel that gave them salvation. And he wanted them to be faithful, to be pure in their devotion to him, so they would be married, so to speak, to Christ. Are you with me right here? Verse 3. But I'm afraid, just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. He says, man, you guys have been pulled away. You've been duped. You've been deceived. For if someone comes to you and preaches a Jesus other than Jesus we preached, or if you receive a different spirit from the one you received, or a different gospel from the one you accepted, you put up with it easily enough. But I don't think I'm in least inferior to those super apostles. I may not be a trained speaker, but I do have knowledge. We have made this perfectly clear to you in every way. What's interesting to me is that in our fellowship, I think that we've learned that all the scriptures are needed at different hours at different times. I mean, in the good times, there's a whole bunch of scriptures that encourage you. Amen, church? And maybe in the bad times, the past few years, we go, wow, I never knew those scriptures there. Those are awesome. Those are great. But what's interesting is we sense, because many of us have come from different congregations, we sense that in some places, there is the preaching of a different Jesus through a different gospel with a different spirit. And we go, wow, it's just different. It's not how I came to know Christ in pure devotion. But we don't connect the dotted lines. We stop right there. The responsibility of where a church is at rests on the shoulders of a church's leadership. If a different Jesus is being preached through a different gospel with a different spirit, then the Bible says that's a false teacher. Read on. Verse 13. For such men are false apostles, deceitful workmen masquerading as apostles of Christ. And no wonder. If Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light, it is not surprising then if his servants masquerade as servants of righteousness. Their end will be what their actions deserve. We need to understand, you know, some of us, we look at the scriptures, we see all the problems of the church at Corinth, whether it be in this church or other churches, but we don't see that there are false brothers. There are false teachers. And as disciples, we need to be able to discern it because the church at Ephesus was commended. Says you've tested those people. How do you test somebody? You test them through the word of God. And you test them by the fruit of the preaching. And you can know whether Jesus and the true gospel through a true spirit is being preached. Because the word of God, when it's planted in its truth, in its pure truth, is going to yield the same fruit in every city. Are you with me here, church? We need to understand, there are false teachers today that talk about autonomy. Every church is independent. The word autonomy is not in the Bible, but brotherhood is. There are false teachers talking about cheap grace. And what's it produce? Lukewarmness. Because no response is motivated by cheap grace. We need to understand that many of our churches have drifted because men are afraid to preach the word of God. Let's get back to the book of Revelation. Hey, those guys at Ephesus, they were doing awesome, weren't they? I mean, they're persevering. They're not tolerating weak men. They're sorting out and they're studying their Bibles. They've endured hardships. They're working hard. They must be doing awesome spiritually. And yet look what the Bible says, verse 4. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. That doesn't sound good to me. Remember the height from which you've fallen, repent, and do the things you did at first. You know, this is a very understandable passage. For those of us that are married, you remember what it was like when you were dating your wife? Remember what it was like when you got engaged and you popped the question, will you marry me? Oh, yes, thank you, thank you. You were fired up. And then the wedding day comes. Now, a lot of times, like Casey Fligor, she's getting all nervous right now about all the plans and everything. And DJ seems like he's Mr. Cool, Calm, and Collected. And that's how it is for a lot of guys until about 5 minutes before you go down the aisle. I will never forget what happened to me. I was in the back room. I was a groom. I was cool, calm, and collected. After all, I was the groom. I had the preacher with me. I had my best man with me. And then word came. Something went wrong. And they just said, "Bro, excuse us." And there I was, all alone. What had happened? Did the roof cave in? Did Elena back out? I'm sitting there, frantic. But then whatever it was gone. And the next thing I remember is Elena walking down the aisle with her dad, dressed in a beautiful white gown, because we've kept our relationship pure. And that white meant something. And then the ceremony, and then the honeymoon. But because we have mixed company and we have single people in the crowd, that is something those of us that are married will keep to ourselves. But let's just say, it was awesome. It was incredible. You know that American expression about the honeymoon? The honeymoon's over? It happened to us. In 3 months, we got in such a bad argument, Elena goes, "I want to go home." 3 months, I go, golly. A month later, Elena was working as an intern in occupational therapy. And she was working at this hospital. And the head administrator at this hospital hits on her. And she goes, "Well, hold it. I just got married 4 months ago. Here's my wedding ring." He says, "Don't worry about it. Doesn't bother me." That's the world. That's the world. It is out to get you. And I'm thankful she had enough Christian commitment, because our marriage was not strong. It was not strong. And I say that to my shame. But she held on because of her commitment. And come December, we celebrate number 29 anniversary. Is that awesome? But right here, guys, the wedding, the honeymoon, that's your baptism. You get married to Christ. Do you remember your baptism? How awesome it was. You came out of that water going, "Thank you, Jesus. All my sins are forgiven. I'm a son of God. I'm in the kingdom of God. I'm going to heaven. Nothing's going to bother me." And then the next day comes. But you know, in God's eyes, with us, nothing's changed. As Elena is my bride, so are we still Christ's bride. So what's changed? Why have we left this exuberant first love where we love studying the Bible, not just for 10 minutes in the morning? We were studying an hour and 2 hours. We were mesmerized by the sermons. We were the last ones around, hanging around the fellowship. We were calling people, see if they wanted to get together at midnight. And then we wanted to get some early morning prayer time on in. We were fired up. We were sharing our faith left and right. We were just so fired up about God. And then the honeymoon ended. And we lost our first love. Where are you today? God calls us to have a first love. You know, I've been married 21 years. I can say with all my heart, I love Elena more today than I did when I got married. I am more fired up about her today in every way than when I got married. Now, we've had some tough times, and praise God for discipling. Amen, church? And we've had some very tough times, but we've made it through, and you can be at a first love state, even when you're very old. So, little hope there, Casey and DJ, amen? Where are you at? You may have persevered. You may know your Bible. You may detect false teachers. You may see things are wrong. You may be working hard. But if you don't have a first love relationship with God, you are in danger of losing your salvation. Let's look at the church at Smyrna. Verse 8. To the angel of the church at Smyrna write, these are the words of him who is the first and last, who died and came to life again. I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. Now, interesting. Smyrna at this time was one of the richest cities in the Roman Empire. And yet the church, being disciples, and you know how it is being a disciple. That's usually not your state in life. Richness, you know what I'm talking about? And so Jesus encouraged him. He says, man, I know your afflictions. I know your poverty, yet you're rich. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but of the synagogue of Satan. Do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful, even to the point of death, and I'll give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death. It's awesome right here. The church at Ephesus was a church that didn't have persecution. It was the comfortable church, and the hearts of the people drifted away from their first love. The situation was good, but dangerous. The situation in Smyrna was quite the opposite. The situation was bad. There was poverty and persecution. Interesting, the little phrase right here, I find. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not. The first century Christians saw themselves to be the true Jews, God's people. They were Messianic Jews. But the Jews that didn't believe in Jesus, they didn't view them as true Jews. They were of the synagogue of Satan. And right here you can see that the strongest persecution, at least in this city, didn't come from the world. It came from the super religious Jews. Isn't that interesting? That sometimes the most bitter persecution comes from those who claim they know God and they know even the Word of God. And right here, Jesus is saying, listen, guys, I'm all over it. I know about your afflictions. I know about your poverty. I know what's going on. I know who the true Christians are. Just be faithful. Faithful even to the point of death. You know, the Apostle John was the only one of the 12 that didn't suffer a direct martyr's death. Now, he was boiled in oil one time, and he should have died, but the Lord took care of him. Is that awesome or not? You know, he had the easy life there in Patmos. No, he didn't. But you know, his most famous personal disciple was a guy named Polycarp. This is a real guy in history. Now, interestingly, Polycarp becomes the bishop, the preacher in Smyrna. Fast forward time to 155 AD. Remember, this was written, Revelation's about 95 AD. And I want to read to you a well-documented historical account of the last hours of our brother Polycarp's life, the leader of the church in Smyrna. The year is 155 AD. Persecution against the Christians broke out in Smyrna, and believers were being fed to the wild beasts in the arena. The crowd began to call for their leader Polycarp, so authorities sent a search party to get him. It was a Friday afternoon. Polycarp was resting upstairs. They came fully armed as if arresting a dangerous criminal. Polycarp's friend wanted him to sneak out. Yet Polycarp said, God's will be done. Polycarp welcomed his captors as if they were friends. He talked with them, ordered food and drink to be served to them. Then Polycarp made a request. May I have 1 hour to pray before you take me away? Well, he took two. That's our brother Polycarp. When brought to the Roman proconsul at the arena, the man thought it senseless of making this aged man a martyr, a witness. He pleaded, curse Christ, and I will release you. Polycarp, raised by Christian parents, said, 86 years I have served him. He has never done me wrong. How then can I blaspheme my king who has saved me? The proconsul, looking for an acceptable way out. Then do this, old man. Just swear by the genius of the emperor, and that'll be sufficient. And of course, what he means is just the spirit of the emperor. So he was kind of letting Polycarp off the hook. But if he would have agreed to that, then he would have acknowledged that there were such things as pagan gods. Polycarp said, if you imagine for a moment that I would do that, then I think you pretend that I do not know who I am. Hear it plainly. I am a Christian. The proconsul threatened him with wild beasts. Polycarp says, bring them forth. I would change my mind if it meant going from worse to better, but not to change from right to wrong. The proconsul's patience is gone. Then you will burn to death. Polycarp said, you threaten fire that burns for an hour and is over, but the judgment on the ungodly is forever. As he burned, he was finished off with the stab of a dagger. And because he was faithful to the end, he overcame. He ate from the tree of life. And he too saw Jesus walking amongst the golden lampstands with the golden sash, with the seven stars in his hands, who handed him a golden crown, and said, well done, good and faithful servant. Let us be faithful to the end. God bless.